Hello, and welcome to this high-level identity and access management portfolio strategy session. My name is Chris Barngrover. I'm a strategist on the NetIQ product leadership team. I'm going to spend the next 10 minutes or so going over the portfolio strategy at a high level, just giving you a sense for how we view the problem of identity access management and drives a lot of our decisions in products and how we address the market. So here we go. So to start with, we're starting with the concept of enabling our customers to be more cyber resilient, right? Enabling the cyber resilience story. And that basically is, you know, when we talk about the resilience definition, it's the dynamic process, emphasis on the word process, that encompasses positive adaptation within the context of adversity. Now, context of adversity, anytime in the last year plus, with the pandemic and all of a sudden having to support a mobile workforce on a short notice, that's pretty much a pretty good definition of the concept of a context of adversity. But the emphasis here is on the processes, right? It's about what processes, what tools you have in place to help enable this positive adaptation when adversity hits. And so when we look at this, organizations these days are constantly under siege, whether it's from bad actors inside or outside, and inside bad actors don't have to be intentional. They can be unintentional bad actors. They can be people that are clumsy with their credentials or share a token or something like this with nothing but good intentions, but still can be a problem. To changing compliance requirements, and changing guidance from leadership, or the aforementioned changing of the world around you, and all of a sudden you have to support a mobile workforce that you didn't used to have to support because of a global pandemic. Point being, things are constantly going to happen. And what organizations need are the protective and detective controls and processes to enable themselves to be more resistant or resilient when those slings and arrows hit, right? Now, when we talk about the processes, I mean, we can go through this in depth on another presentation, but essentially what we're talking about are fairly uniform, fairly defined processes, but it's the tools with which you implement these that can make the difference, and the processes you build around those tools, right? But this is not a one shot and you're done concept. This is something that needs to grow and evolve over time. These protective and detective controls with the intention of getting to the point eventually where you can now intelligently adapt to the world as it's changing around you, right? And this is very much our story, helping our customers mature to the point where they can now intelligently adapt to what's coming. Now, cyber resilience helps as a key component with any kind of breach defense framework. But if you look at the NIST cybersecurity framework, for example, you know, this is all part of it, right? The ability to see and understand the problem, to implement protective and detective controls, to have that real-time monitoring of what's happening, being able to respond to and then get back to business once a breach has occurred. Key component of this is this cyber resilience, being able to bounce back, right? Being able to see what's happening and recover and not let it shut you down for an extended period of time. So when we talk about the ability to intelligently adapt, what are we talking about? So if we look at an identity and access management maturity curve, right, and how this looks over time and over as you get more robust processes and more capable processes, you move from an assumed trust model in the trust world where typically the emphasis is on securing the perimeter, right? This is usually a network-centric security perspective. It takes very much a friendly versus unfriendly, inside versus outside approach to what's happening. You know, if I can build a strong enough wall and a high enough wall, then the people on the outside of the wall are the bad guys, and people on the inside of the wall are the good guys. Well, this has proven to be obviously false over the years. And one of the last nails in the coffin was the SolarWinds breach for the United States federal government. But you can extend this argument to basically anything that looks at something in the concept of a security silo, because that's essentially what this is. If you talk about network segmentation even, well, that's great. It's better, but it's still just a wall within a wall within a wall, a silo of security, right? And typically this will have a narrow security scope. Point solutions typically fall into this bucket as well. A point solution can solve a discrete problem very well, but it won't solve that problem with an eye to the next problem you're going to solve. It only has the view of how it solves that problem and understands that problem. For example, if I'm going to solve a multi-factor problem, I need to see and understand the privilege problem I've got coming over the horizon or the governance problem I've got coming over the horizon and be able to solve that multi-factor problem in a way that at least doesn't make the other problems harder to solve. Ideally works with and makes those problems easier to solve. So, but anyway, this assumed trust model, as we start maturing and getting out of this and getting into this verification mindset or a zero trust mindset, where you start looking at and enforcing the least privileged access. I don't need unnecessary access floating around, you know, in the network centric world, I VPN. And then once I'm over that final wall, I have complete and usually unfettered access to that portion of the world I can see. Well, I mean, a least privileged access model is far superior, right? But it does require a more mature concept and understanding of risk. Because now I need to know where I need greater security and where I don't, what of my resources that I'm protecting need to have more granular security, need to have that capability. I need to constantly be evaluating both assurances and entitlements, right? Who is this actor? Should they really get access to what they're requesting? And so on and so forth. But one of the really cool side effects of a least privileged model or a zero trust model is it does typically offer a more seamless user experience. So instead of having to fight my way through a VPN or multiple VPNs and then navigate on the network, I just usually, typically in this model, you just request the resource and then the security infrastructure will evaluate, does this actor need access to this based on the context of the situation, whatever it's evaluating. It's, you're just making a request and getting a response. So it does typically make for a more seamless user experience. Now, zero trust is a huge step forward over assumed trust. But if we're going to decalcify and make the move, we want to enable our customers to get to this concept of adaptive intelligence, right? Where you can recognize something that's happening as it's happening or even before it's happening, right? So this is typically going to leverage both behavioral and data-driven analytics. It is going to build upon that concept of assurance and entitlement to the concept of a continuous authentication and authorization model, right? Meaning not one shot and you're done, but entire time an actor is interacting with the resources I'm protecting, I'm constantly reevaluating the risk, constantly reevaluating should the authorization need to change based on a change in risk, based on behavior, based on whatever, right? And this really leads to the ability to do near real-time or actual real-time response and remediation, to see things as they're occurring. And even in the predictive modeling world, get to where you can even see them coming ahead of time, right? Now, when I've presented this slide in the past, I've always talked about how there are some customers that don't really need to get to adaptive intelligence all the way to recognize either or shouldn't spend the money to do that. And the case in point was the school district where my children go to school. They've been one of our customers in the identity management world for a very long time now. And I always said that if they spent the money, my tax dollars, to protect my kids' lunch account, library account, whatever, in a, you know, dynamic behavioral analytics way, I would question whether that was a good use of my tax dollars. But with more and more of these assets being cloud delivered, being able to be leveraged on a service basis, if our school district where I live wants to use this technology, it's a whole lot lower barrier to entry, both technology from a technology point of view and from a cost point of view. With cloud delivered, software delivered as a service, I don't have to have necessarily data scientists on staff to make this go. I can just run it as a service, feed it logs, and get the results back. The ability then is what we're trying to do, is drive down those barriers to entry, both cost and technology barriers to entry, to enable as many of our customers that want to make this journey, enable them to make as possible to make that journey. So this is basically our story. We really want to try to drive down the cost, drive down the technology burdens, and enable our customers to realize the concept of being able to intelligently adapt to things that are happening in the world around them to help enable their cyber resilience. And if you look at this from a identity and access management high level capability point of view, you'll recognize, well, there are certain identity access management capabilities like password management, like single sign-on, that are common in an assumed trust model. But as I get into a zero trust model, if I'm talking about identity governance or data governance or things that I really need a concept of risk and a more mature concept of risk before I can actually make full use of these capabilities, privilege access management, for example, you'll see those capabilities typically fall a little more into that middle tier. And getting up into the adaptive intelligence side of that continuous auth in and auth z capability, you know, the difference between just rote data governance and actual contextually aware data privacy, you know, leveraging analytics and clearly leveraging machine learning to do any of this at scale. But point being, whatever problem along this spectrum you're trying to solve, whether back to the model we talked about, if I'm trying to solve a multi-factor problem right now, let's do so in a way that will support and enable me more ably solve the next problem coming over the hill, whether that's identity governance, privilege access, et cetera. So this is very much our story going to the world, being able to help you solve not the problem you're on now alone, but with an eye to how to solve the next problem and do so from a single vendor. Thank you very much for your time.